Great question.
Thank you. And I, too, would congratulate you all. This has been a monumentous task. You're not finished yet. In fact, the hard part is next, in all honesty. Patrick, I did have one question when we had the discussion about the regional housing needs assessment numbers 2 weeks, 3 weeks ago, and there was this back and forth discussion as to whether 20 units or 30 units per acre was going to be the acceptable numbers. Is that one of the issues that's going to kind of be addressed through the focused areas, El Camino Real, Encinitas Boulevard, the need for the additional multi-family housing?
Yes, in our mixed use, we are looking at a 30 unit per acre density, but still trying to keep that within three stories. So we are going to be designing a mixed use standard to accommodate that. State law defines it as 30, so that's what we're going with. What we will be doing is in our alternative section of the EIR, start looking at paring that down as to where maybe a lesser amount of mixed use could occur. But we're going with kind of the preferred project and working through the alternatives depending on what the environmental impacts come out, because the alternatives are designed to try to minimize or reduce or lessen the impacts. So you will see some variations, but our alternatives in the EIR are going to try to stay within those focus areas to the extent we can, because that's what the community wanted us to look at. So that's been our goal, but it is a 30 units per acre.
Thank you. And I, too, support the 60-day. I think that's going to give the public a little extra opportunity to. I have a suspicion that it's going to be a fairly large document.
Oh, along with the public outreach, we will be changing our comment board to do it by element.
Great.
So when the document's released, you'll be able to go on the webpage, look at the element, and then give comments in relationship to that. So hopefully we can get comments that way.
Have you gotten comments since you started this program, you know, having the online opportunity?
My comments are still there.
There's a few. Most of the comments are on the community character topic, but there are some topics that haven't received any contributions. So we'd like to see more, and it's still open. So if you want to encourage people to log on and blog, please do so.
Thank you. The idea where before mixed use was horizontal, commercial, retail in the bottom, first, second floor apartments. But now there's starting to be a somewhat of a talk of making it vertical, where you would actually have a residence or the entrance to a group of residents right on the street. So it's a somewhat intriguing approach to mixed use, so that it's not as static as retail on the bottom or commercial on the bottom and apartments on the top. So I thought that was a different approach to mixed use.
Yeah, I'm glad you brought that up. That is a very interesting phenomena. The so-called new urbanism has become its own cliche. Actually, housing over retail. You look at it and say, hey, didn't I just see that in Petaluma, and there it is in San Diego, and there it is in Escondido? It's like everybody's doing it. So it loses the context sensitivity. It often doesn't fully address ecological, organic type forms, and use still does matter. What just be to retail? Because you can easily over-retail the environment and end up with a lot of vacant storefronts, and then it sets the concept back because the developers will say, well, this doesn't work, and they come out to undermine the land use and design. So we have to be very sophisticated about that issue.
Couple questions for you. The definition of light industrial, please. What types of businesses would fit into this category?
Support, shaping.
Mm-hmm.
It's up there in our light industrial. We have automotive repair in our light industrial. Those are probably about the heaviest uses. You could have a cabinet shop, but more the soft uses are where someone does an office in front, and they have a big garage door in back, and it might be a printery, but they handle their customers in front. They do all their printing in the back. With a garage door that accommodates delivery. So that's maybe a light type of use of industrial. Our heaviest is really the surfboard shaping, the cabinet making, and the automotive repair that we currently have, and continuous tile setting. Tile Store, where is the shop, but they have a lot of deliveries.
In general, in your presentation here at Council, how were the bullet points selected in each of those areas? In other words, what was the threshold you were using to determine those top bullet points that we saw?
Summary here, we tried to highlight primarily the areas of policy that are new or additive to the general plan you already have. So the combination of those two things.
Okay. Well, that makes more sense, too, because, well, it would be nice to just, you know, embrace the entire document, and it's really nice in this form and in bullet point. There are several issues highlighted here that are going to be highly controversial in this community.
Right.
I know just, you know, on prior experience of issues that we've discussed. And so, you know, my concern is that, you know, while it's okay as a bullet point here, the discussion later on down the road is going to be a lengthy one, and I just want to make sure that that discussion, you know, will happen with the community and with the council.
Mm-hmm.
Because what I don't want to see happen is to put this document out here and say, well, this is our draft. You know, you can look at it for informational purposes and make your comments, but really there isn't much flexibility in this document. And then, you know, come back and bring something before council that's very heated within the community. I'd rather see something all along that's able to be adapted with the community input. And then when it comes to council, of course, we'll have those types of discussions. But I just want to make sure that, you know, it really is the case that that input and that involvement, you know, it's not too late to have those discussions as community members, especially on some of these topics. You know, a great one to pick out and address is the private views. I know that's something that's not going to come, you know, with consensus among the community. So, you know, there's just things that I can look to and know later on down the road that they're going to be a challenge. And I just want to make sure that when I'm reading the timeline, that we're not just dumping a document, you know, on the community, and that we're actively soliciting comments and input. And because I think that's very valuable, you know, for a council member to be able to have access to that type of information and that have that type of outreach, I think, will be critical moving forward.
And kind of just as to go along with that, if you think about the draft general plan at the workshop on September 19th, and until we get to public hearings the first part of 2012, we envision that we'll have lots of comments, and we want lots of comments, and we want to keep track of each one of those and how they're being dealt with. By the time it gets to the Planning Commission at the hearing, staff may already be saying, this is really a good policy. We need to include it, and it may become part of that general plan. Or as community says, gee, the language doesn't quite work, like the advisory committee said on several issues, then we may be tweaking that language. So we hope that the community will be able to track it and
like,
see that we're listening to
them. A little bit later in
them.
The process when the details are laid out, that's when it's going to be very important to look closely, you know, from community member standpoint, and of course always from council, because some of these questions, just to be honest, you know, in the workshop you'd have to have a lot more in the way of background, in my opinion, of the pros and cons of doing some of these things before you could fully answer the question. The one question that stuck out in my mind at the workshop was the one about the space and the parkland use designation and whether we should separate that out. Well, the first question that went through my mind was, what are the pros, what are the cons? I don't really have the information I would need to fully understand that issue and check yes or no, and, you know, it may sound great here in the question. So it sounds like later on all of these items will be fully vetted and have the pros and cons and the staff recommendation, and